And welcome to this new episode of Ask Stago, the podcast dedicated to provide expert answers to your expert question in hemostasis. I am Cécile Roquet, and I'm so glad to be the co-host again today with Audrey Carlo. In this episode, we will be questioning the thrombotic risk associated with hormonal treatments.
And yes, Cécile, and this is not because we are women that this topic is covered today, but probably because there were questions coming from the field and in public media comparing incidence of COVID-19 vaccine-induced thrombosis with thrombosis under pill. And we are lucky to have an expert guest on the topic today, Laure Morimont. Laure, you are project leader at QualiBlood SA, and you are doing your PhD exactly on this topic, so you are developing the most up-to-date knowledge on the matter. Hello, Laure, and thank you for having accepted our invitation.
Good morning, Audrey and Cécile. I thank you for inviting me to this session. Indeed, for the past 3 years, I've been working on my project entitled Hormone-Induced Coagulopathy, whose objective is to assess the risk of thromboembolic event associated with hormonal therapies, such as combined oral contraceptives.
Hello, Laure. It's a pleasure. Our bit here is to start with the basics. So can you tell us how frequent are thrombotic under hormonal therapy?
Yeah, so it's difficult to have worldwide database, but for example, in Wallonia, the south region of Belgium, with 3.6 million inhabitants, but with wide access to oral contraception for young women, there are more than 700 VTA each year.
That's huge.
And here you're talking about reported thrombosis under oral contraception, but I'm sure there is a hidden part of the iceberg with non-reported events or events under hormonal replacement therapies during menopause, for example.
Yes, definitely. Oral contraceptives is a subgroup of hormonal therapies, and the risk of VTE is also increased in women undergoing in vitro fertilization, during pregnancy and postpartum, of course, and also in menopausal women undergoing hormonal replacement therapy. In other words, the majority of women are concerned at some point during their lives.
Actually, I found the number quite high. Focusing on oral contraception, is it the relative risk for thrombosis the same whatever the pill you are taking?
Well, not talking about pill brand names, but we know that there are different so-called generations, namely second, third, and fourth generation combined oral contraceptives. And the risk of thrombosis is higher with third and fourth generation compared to the second one. So why? Well, certainly the estrogen derivative is the main responsible for the increased risk of thrombosis, but the progestin, depending on its pharmacodynamic properties, balances out to a certain degree the estrogen-dependent alteration in hemostasis and hepatic protein synthesis. So in this case, the levonorgestrel found in second-generation COC counterbalance more the effect of the ethanyl estradiol compared to desogestrel or gestodine found in third-generation COC.
And actually, oral contraception and hormonal replacement therapies are often listed as well in acquired thrombophilia disorders. So, Laure, maybe can you describe the mechanism that lead to this thrombogenicity of these treatments?
Yes, so as I mentioned above, oral contraceptives impact the synthesis of coagulation factors that are synthesized in the liver. They impact positively the procoagulant pathway with increased level of prothrombin, factor 7, factor 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12. On the other hand, they impact negatively the anticoagulant pathway with decreased level of antithrombin, protein S, and tissue factor pathway inhibitors. In addition to all these changes, COC use leads to an acquired resistance to the activated protein C, which represents an independent risk factor of VTE.
While we know for more than 60 years that pill put women at risk for thrombosis, how are pharma companies developing new treatments? Are there any authorities asking for proof of a low effect on coagulation?
Well, in 2005, the European Medicines Agency updated its guideline on clinical investigation of steroid contraceptives in women, in which they recommended the assessment of several hemostasis parameters, among which the assessment of APC resistance. Furthermore, in 2013, following a review to re-evaluate the benefit-risk balances of COC, the EMA stated the importance of providing clear and updated information to women who use this product and the crucial role of healthcare professionals giving advice and clinical care. They also mention that the individual risk should be re-evaluated periodically as risk factor for VTE can change over the course of a lifetime.
And so that's very clear that indeed, probably here the APC resistance assessment of thrombogenicity is also connected with the lowering of antithrombin and protein S levels, as you mentioned before.
Yeah, absolutely. And Cécile, to come back to your questions, actually, all pharma companies are running clinical trials in which the impacted coagulation factors I mentioned earlier are assessed on plasma from patient samples. Indeed, as the incidence of thromboembolic event during clinical trials is weak due to low number of patients, they rely on lab data to assess the thrombogenicity of patients.
Okay, thank you, Laure. And would you have some key messages you would like our listeners to keep in mind from the podcast of today?
Yes. So, well, for women who are listening, don't hesitate to ask your gynecologist or your general practitioner about the risk associated with your birth control method. Don't forget that venous thromboembolism is a multifactorial disease whose occurrence depends on the interaction between gene defects, such as factor V latent, and environmental factors, such as oral contraception, but also smoking habits, immobilization, or even long travel. Finally, even if laboratory investigation not proven to be useful on a population-wide basis, assays performed during the development of steroid contraceptives might get more room in the regular risk assessment for women.
Thank you very much, Laure, for this conclusion and for having clarified the question. But I feel we still have a lot to learn.
Still a lot to learn, yes. But there's a hope somehow with new techniques that could be developed and make the hormonal treatment enter more and do the personalized medicine area.
Yes, the light of hope, Audrey. So thank you again, Laure, for your time today. And thank you all for listening. As usual, you will find relevant literature sources in the podcast description. You can follow us on LinkedIn or Twitter or subscribe to Ask a Stego podcast channel on your favorite platform. And please feel free to send us any question that you may have at our email address, ask@stego.com. We'll be glad to answer to it in the next episode. See you next time.
This podcast is brought to you by Stago. Diagnostics is in our blood.